Good. Hi, everyone. So today we'll discuss the DOM and how to modify it with JavaScript. I would assume that jQuery will continue jQuery next week, because there is a lot that we want to do today with the DOM. And I will start directly the lecture, and then I will return to other things like the assignment and the quiz for today. Okay. So let's discuss first the DOM, and I will do a couple of examples through the lecture today. So there are two topics that I want to discuss today. I want to discuss the DOM and JavaScript to modify it, and next class we'll do jQuery and a simplified way to modify it. So the first thing is the fact that actually JavaScript sees the HTML document that is opened in the browser as a tree of objects and attributes. So the tags in your document are basically translated into a document object model, which is in essence a tree. The HTML document has basically children, which are head and body. And then within the head, you can have other tags, like, for instance, title, the text under that title. So that's a specific type of element, which is the text element within a certain tag. You may have script. You may have other tags under head. Then you have element body as another child of HTML. And under body, you may have a link, like, for instance, anchor with an attribute href. In this case, I put here the attribute, but really is not a child. It's an attribute of the current element, the current tag. And we can see that under this element anchor, there is text, which is the text for that link. Then you may have other children, tags, or elements of the body, like header one, and then the text under header one, then paragraph, and then the text under the paragraph, and so on. And this goes down, like, for instance, under a paragraph, you may have a division. Under a division, you may have a table and all of that. So it's really the way that HTML, an HTML document is loaded inside the browser is as a tree. And this tree is called the document object model. It's a tree of elements which are called objects in the object model. And those objects have children and attributes. And that's exactly what the browser sees a web page. Now, the advantage of JavaScript is that it can change any HTML element. So the JavaScript can do any update on this tree. Can change any HTML doc element, like, for instance, you can change the attributes, you can change an href of an anchor, you can add additional attributes, you can change the style, basically, you can basically change the color, the font, the border of an element, you can remove completely any HTML element or attribute. You can add additional HTML attributes, HTML elements and attributes for any node. Basically, you can go to the parent, and from the parent, you can remove a child, or you can add another child at any position under the parent. You can react to existing HTML events. So on click, for instance, if the user clicks on a certain element, now doesn't matter what that element is, like a paragraph, even just action. If the user starts typing and in an input, you can react immediately to those HTML events. You can get the entire text of the input, check if it's a word in the dictionary, and basically offer autocorrect options to the user. You can create new HTML events, which basically will trigger other JavaScript commands. So let's see basically the basics of how to do that. First of all, HTML elements in this model are objects. And these objects have properties. like members that can be altered with JavaScript. The DOM provides methods that may access all of the HTML elements in the DOM. The DOM defines events for all of the HTML elements that we can basically capture and trigger JavaScript code. As with object-oriented paradigms, methods are actions that can be performed, and properties are values that can be altered. And let's see how to do that. So first of all, the HTML DOM has references to any element, or the below get methods start with document, the entire DOM, and you can get an element by ID. So it finds all of the elements with a matching ID. Basically, when you define a paragraph or a div, you give an ID. You can give an ID attribute for that paragraph or div. You can get elements by tag name, and it finds all the elements based on their tag name, like, for instance, paragraph or div. You basically get every single, all the elements into a list of elements. You can get elements by class. That basically means that you find all of the elements where the class matches the attribute class equal and that name. So basically the name, you get all of the attributes with that specific name. All of these methods get element either by ID, by tag name, or by class may return more than one object. So basically you get a list of objects, and we will use indices or subscripts to get that specific object. Now, once you get an element in this DOM tree, you can basically get multiple properties of this element. You can get the inner HTML, basically the HTML content of that element. You can get any attribute of that element. So attribute is basically a name for the attribute. So element dot, and then you can put the attribute that you want. Like, for instance, element dot ID, or element dot class, or element dot href. And that basically gives you the element, the attribute that you're looking for. Or you can modify any CSS property, style property of that element. So for that element, dot style, dot, and then you replace property by the name of that specific style, like background color or background image. And you can use them either for reading the value, like, for instance, you can read the inner HTML from that document, or to assign another HTML to that specific element. So let's start with a simple example. So this is an HTML file that basically has a header, hello world. It has two unnumbered lists, one that contains list item one and list item two, and another one that contains list item three and four. And I also have a follow-up paragraph, which is empty. It's basically nothing there, which has the ID demo. Okay, so simple HTML document. If you read it and write it in a text document, and I'm actually going to do that. Now, I would do it with Xcode, let's put JS examples, and I'm going to use VS Code, since last time I basically told you that we should start using it. And first thing that I usually do, I add a folder to my workspace. So let's JS example, I'm going to add it to the workspace. There is nothing in it yet, so I start creating files. Let's create a file, index.html. And in index.html, I basically paste my code. And I format it nicely, so it looks pretty nice. Okay, so if I want to run this, I can run it in two different ways. At this moment, because we only have HTML files, we can just open it with our favorite browsers. Okay, But in the future, because we will start using basically as servers, you should install extensions. And one popular extension for servers is, let's see, server, live server. It's basically we can install it and it will create a server on our machine. So we can actually run it directly from our workspace. Other extensions that you can install are Pretty Printers, which will use Pretty Formatters for JSON, for instance. It will make it easy for us to actually format JSON and see it nicely, and so on. We'll basically start with these two. You can also use the console, because this is basically connected to Node.js to install any packages that you want. Okay, so at this point, we can actually run it. It was the first open with live server. And we can see that it runs on port 5500. You can basically open this in any tab because it's basically the port number for that active server that we just created. Okay. So we can actually see that our code looks, our HTML looks like this. Okay, good. So now we can actually modify it using the DOM. So first way is to do it in the console. So basically in this example, I'm creating a variable X that is all of the elements we tag li, which in our document, there were four elements we tag li, list item one, list item two, list item three, and list item four. So X will be a list of all of the elements we tag li, and you can actually print them so you can see what those elements were. And then from the same document, we get the element with ID demo, and we set the inner HTML to be equal with, and here we actually are going to using X. So X were all of the list items. So the first list item is x0.innerHTML. So it basically we are stealing list item one from inside the first item in X. Then we add a break, and then the second item is x1.innerHTML. Then we add a break. Then the third item is x2.innerHTML, and the fourth item is x3.innerHTML. Once we did that, another thing that we can do is to set for that specific element that we created, that we got, the element with ID demo, the style color property to be equal with red. So basically what we just did, we extracted the element, all the elements with tag li, and then we set for the element with tag demo, the inner HTML to be this specific HTML code, and then we also set the style to be red. So the result after running those will basically be the same web page that we saw before, but now that paragraph that we add at the end with ID demo contains all of this. Basically, we created the HTML out of the HTML that we extracted for item one. And we also set the color for that HTML to be red. So this can be done in multiple ways. So one way, let me actually correct this demo, this typo, is that you are running all of this directly in the console. So we can do that by more tools, developer tools, and in the console, basically the first thing I extracted X to be the list of all of the list items that we had here. Then the next thing is that we set the demo. So in this HTML, if you look at the source, right at the end, we have this demo code. And now we will basically insert it in that code. So here we are going to say that the inner HTML for demo will contain this from X, the inner HTML at index 0, which is item, basically this, then concatenated with new line, and the second item will be the inner HTML of X1. X1 was basically the second element that we extracted in X by tag name li, and then we continued and we added the other two HTMLs. So we set the HTML for demo to be the concatenation of all of the HTMLs for those inner HTMLs that we got from X. And the last thing that we did, we actually set the color for our demo tag to be red. And that basically set this color to be red. So this is one way to do it. Basically, you're trying your code, your JavaScript code directly in the console. And once you develop a JavaScript code that you like, you can basically start modifying directly in the code, in the HTML.
Wait, Professor, I have a question.
Go ahead.
When you are like modifying the DOM structure, does it is it reflected on the HTML source?
No. So if you look at the source, the demo is still an empty paragraph. It so it's only the DOM, basically what is currently loaded in the page.
Thank you.
So you can check that by looking at the source at any moment, but it doesn't reflect in the source. It only reflects in what you see in the page. Very good question. Okay, so the first way to do it, that the first way that we did was we had a static HTML, then we basically tested our JavaScript to get elements and set elements with different values. And we basically got elements by tag, we got elements by ID, and then we set the inner HTML with values that we got from that list of inner HTMLs. The second thing that we did, we use the style property of the element that we extracted, and we changed the color to red. And that basically was reflected in the output. Okay, but now we want actually this to actually be to run in the code itself. Okay, and we will do it in the next example. So next example, this example, basically it's a different example, and I will use it to show you how to plug this stuff into the HTML example itself, and then how to plug it in a different file, and then how to plug it in the code itself, like basically as a script. Okay, so let's start with the example per se. So in this example, basically we have similar HTML file. We had four paragraphs, one that has ID 1, and this paragraph, the text from paragraph 1, then another one that has ID 2, and this is a text from paragraph 2, another third one that is basically similar with 3. Then we have one that has class unusual, and this is the text for it, is this is an unusual paragraph. Now, what we want is to capture the unusual paragraph using a selector. And we basically use the selector p.unusualParagraph. So p.unusualParagraph says that I want paragraph p. So this is similar to select items by tag. But under the paragraph p, I want those that have unusual class. So it will basically use P as the element and unusual as the selector within that element. So from all of these paragraphs, it selects the one that has class unusual. And that will be in the variable X. Now, again, all of these can actually get multiple results. So even when we are going to use it, we are going to use it as X or at element 0, because you may have multiple that have class unusual. So in the second part, I'm basically getting again the element with ID demo, and I'm setting the HTML to be the HTML within the element x0. So again, if you run only this HTML, you will just get the upper part of our page. So let's go back to Xcode, and I will use the same file. If you want to format something, you basically have to select everything, and then Alt-Shift-F will format it to look nice. There are also some extensions that formats differently. But basically, at this point, if you run it, you will basically just get the static HTML. You have the capture, then you have the empty demo, which in this case is totally empty. So again, for running the code in the console, so we are going to run again the developer tools. Control Shift I is to actually start it. You can copy and paste the code. So in this case, we define a variable x that is the unusual paragraph. Then you set the inner HTML to be that unusual paragraph, which added this specific line here. Okay. So now this is the how to run it in the console. Go ahead.
So Professor, I have a question. The question is, so if you reload the page, it will automatically remove that change that you just made, right?
Yes. So I just pressed F5, and it's basically, you don't have that JavaScript run anymore. So if you want, you can run it again. But the moment that you reload the original HTML. All the JavaScript that was run in the console was lost. Okay. So now how do we include it in the HTML per se? So basically we add a script element right at the end, which loads demo.javascript, where demo.javascript is the code that we basically ran before. So we are going to do this little change in our program. So here we have script src is equal with demo.js. Okay. Automatically does autocomplete, which I don't really like, but it's okay. And now we can add a new file, demo.js. Oops, actually misspelled it. And here we can paste our code that we had. So now our HTML will also run that script. It's customary to put this script at the end because the script itself looks for specific parts of the code. Like for instance, the script has to be run after the element with ID demo is actually defined. So that's why I'm putting this script right at the end, after I basically load the entire page, including that ID, that paragraph with ID demo, and then I load the script because the script immediately starts running and looks for the element with ID demo. Okay. So again, let's run it. And now directly we can see that it generated the this is an unusual paragraph. Okay.
Professor, I have another question.
Go ahead.
Well, if you include it in the script rather than running it on through console, then it will update the HTML source?
No, it doesn't. And that's why I opened the view source to show you that the JavaScript is still ran on the client. Sorry.
Wait, then when does the actual HTML source code change if you do something with the JavaScript?
It doesn't.
It doesn't?
No, it doesn't. Because basically the HTML code goes from the server to the client, and the client starts loading that HTML. And when it gets to the script, it executes that script because we didn't have a function here. We basically just started running JavaScript. So the client will be the one starting loading this entire thing.
Thank you.
Welcome. And that's why I opened the source to show you that the demo ID is still empty. And basically, it's the same, although we can see that now it has some text there. Okay, good. Now, you don't want to, if you don't want to put the code in a different file, then you can basically just put it here in the script directly here. So now we basically run the script or load the script directly in the file itself. So this is, in fact, the next example, which does exactly the same thing, but it doesn't load the script from a different file, demo.js. It has it in the current file. Okay. So that's actually the next example where I took the code that was in demo and I put it in the current HTML and it generated that specific image. Okay. Before we continue with JavaScript document write, any questions? Actually, let me go to the chat because there are students that probably posted questions in the chat. Wow. Okay. So let's. It's due at midnight. You can put the quiz up to midnight. It's really you. Okay. So let's, because everybody's talking about the quiz. This quiz is intended to help you with the homework. So really, it's a simple show hidden HTML that contains check buttons to show and hide CSS 316 and 416 descriptions. And really, how it looks like is like this. You basically have two buttons. And as you click them, it hides and shows the course descriptions and the course coordinator and stuff, which I actually took from the web page for that specific class. And similarly for 416, does it's supposed to do the same thing? Yes, it does. It's just put at the end because here this space is actually taken by the other one. So really it's an example of how to solve the homework. Because the homework is something much bigger than that. In the homework for this week, I'm giving you, for these 2 weeks, I give you 2 weeks for it. I'm giving you the list of all the classes offered in the spring, from CSE 101 to graduate classes like CSE 5 or 6 and so on. These are basically operating systems and so on, graduate classes. So 101 classes offered in the department in the spring semester, undergraduate and graduate. And the requirement for the homework is basically to implement something similar to the quiz. You have the list of all the courses, including their titles, which you have to get from the CS web page for courses. Both undergraduate programs and graduate programs have the list of all the courses. And basically for each course, when somebody clicks on that specific title, it should expand to the entire course. Basically, what's the status? What you know, you can put, like if you don't know something, you can leave empty. Like for instance, the class number you probably don't have, but I can actually populate this CSV file to contain class numbers. But other than that, like for instance, the period is there, the instructor is there, the time is there, and so on. Those you should put in the page. And really, you should create this page of all the courses offered in the spring and play with it, basically implement JavaScript to generate this. Since there are 100 classes, one thing that you should think about is how to optimize it. So instead of actually writing HTML for all of these that are shown and hidden, probably you should use JavaScript and while loops to iterate over objects and populate these specific courses. So think about how to make it cooler than just HTML for 100 classes. Any questions? Let's go over the rest of the questions. Okay. Why do we have to format 100 classes? Practice. So basically, it's really practice. HTML and web development is a lot of repetition. And okay, you prove that you understand. I understand if you do 10 of them, but really you should do them all. So, and as I said, you should try to improve it, make it more efficient. So think about how to do it. Maybe you can actually transform this CSV into JavaScript objects. And then all that you have to do is to use JavaScript to parse this into what we actually want as an output. So you can do it in two ways. You can do it manually, or you can do it in a smarter way. And then you don't have to, it doesn't matter if you do it for 100 classes or for 1,000 classes. The assignments this semester are on the same line. Basically, you have to develop incrementally such a system similar to SBU class find, and then basically a schedule builder for your schedule next semester. So really, you should be, at some point we'll do a backend, but you should be able to search specific classes like CSC 101 or CSC 316 and only show those classes. So basically, we will improve this in time. So this is just one step after the step that you did last week towards the final project. And that's exactly what people tell you here to do. Try to write JavaScript functions to do it in an efficient way. Okay. You don't have to, actually, at this point, you can't really read the CSV file. You have to actually encode everything into one HTML file. So I would propose that you actually transform this into a JavaScript objects. Yeah. Live server and pretty JSON. Everything will be in the video. By the way, there are many different editors that you can use. I prefer JStudio, but on my machine I have Atom, I have Brackets, I have Sublime. Also, you can use WebStorm. So as a student, you have academic license for the JetBrains WebStorm, which also it's a very good tool that you can use. And in my case, I'm also using Notepad++ in many cases. So you should try different tools. Atom, Sublime are all good tools. WebStorm is very good, and you can actually, I edited the same code this morning in WebStorm, in Sublime, in Atom, and so on. So really you should use them because you learn how to use these tools. Click on the file and select the first option. So when you click on the file, open with live server, we'll let you open with live server. Okay. Okay. I think most of the questions I will respond after the class because there are about the same issue. Okay, good. Let's continue the lecture. Okay, so the next is actually how to write directly in the document. So document.write will add text directly in an HTML page. And here I have an example. So basically I have loaded an entire code, and then I basically add a script, and document.write will write at the current position in the HTML. which basically will actually create, in this case, again, hello today and the date when I basically wrote this lecture notes in this case. So document write writes in the document, in the HTML document, at the position where that script is actually loaded. So again, I'm going to load this. And again, this is run on the server. So basically, once you load it, you will see that if you look in the source, that date is not there. It's still the script that says, hello, today is, and then it calls the date. So document.write is to write directly in the structure of the loaded page in the DOM. So the DOM is different than the source. The source is still the original source. Changing attributes. So until now, we changed elements, but you can also change attributes. So for instance, one element that I can have in my page is an image and a photo of me, paul1.jpg. I can change that attribute to a different image. So I get the element with ID image one, basically the image that I had, dot source, which is the attribute that I want to change, and I basically modify it with paul2.jpg. So basically, I can modify what image will be shown in that specific place in that image tag. Changing styles. So one way that I told you how to do it was to basically that for the object that you got from the DOM, you can change the property name, the property within that style with any property that you want. Now, one thing that you have to be careful is that object is the object returned by any of the XXX calls. So you are getting all of the objects. Style is just a keyword to indicate the upcoming field is a style attribute. And then the property name is the name of that property, CSS property that you want to modify. So in this example, basically what I would want to do is same example that we loaded before, basically a document that has two lists, list one and list two. And I want to basically modify some of the values. So everything else is the same with before, but now in the elements that I'm getting with tag li, the element at index one, which is the second tag, list two, is set, the style is set, the color property is set to red. The element at index three, which is actually list item four, will change the color to green. The style font size for the first the element at index one, which is list two, is changed to 16 points, so it's a little bit bigger. The border style for the same element is changed to dashed, and the border width to 2 points instead of 1 point. So basically everything that we had before, plus we played a little bit with the attributes, the style properties of various attributes that we collected. Okay, so again, let's test this. So I'm going to load the same HTML that I modified and load it with Active Server. And then I'm going to run the same code. So basically the first part adds the items on the bottom. Okay. And this, the last three are basically changing the color of item two. The color of item three, which is basically the list item four. Then I'm changing the font size, the border, and the border width for item at index one, which is basically the same item that I had for li. So basically item two. Okay. So this changes CSS. Good. Any questions? Okay, good. Next, code that executes when an event occurs. And this event can be any of the following. On click, when the user clicks on a paragraph or any kind of object. When the page is loaded, on load. So at the time that the page is loaded or unloaded, you execute code, JavaScript code. When an image is loaded, on load, you basically execute JavaScript code. When the mouse is over an element without even clicking on mouse over for any element, basically you can add on mouse over, on click, and so on, as basically the method that will call some JavaScript. On mouse out, when you exit with the mouse from a certain region, when an input field is changed, like for instance, you start typing in an input field in a form, when an HTML form is submitted, basically when you click enter on an item, or when you click on a button that's on submit, and when a user strokes a key on key press. So the moment that you stroke a key inside the input. So how exactly can you run that code? And it's right here. So a new attribute on click or on mouse over, for any element, you can basically add what happens for that specific event. So in this case, it's a simple HTML page, which creates a header, my heading one, and then a button under it, which basically has the text click me. So right after I load this simple page, the page will look like this. But the moment that I click on the button, this JavaScript code will be executed. So usually it's a method that it's put here, and you basically, for that specific function, you call it from JavaScript, but you can put directly JavaScript code. So in this specific JavaScript code, I'm getting the element with ID 1, which is the header that I had before that was with ID 1. And I changed the style color to red. And we can see that after I actually do that click, it will change the page to have my header with red. So let's test it. So as I said, it's basically completely black, but when the moment that you click it, it becomes red. And again, if you take a look at the source, it doesn't change the style of my heading one. It's just executing JavaScript code to basically modify the DOM that is loaded in the page. Same if you reload, it loads the original HTML. Okay. Now, also, you should try the other methods, like basically on mouse over, what would happen. It will basically do the change of color. Even if you just go with the mouse over that button, it will still modify the color. So play with any one of the events that are listed here. Okay. Now, JavaScript can also modify the DOM of a document and add and remove elements. And sometimes we have to go to the parent to remove an element, because you can't remove an element from itself. Okay. So first of all, how to create new elements. So let's assume that we want to create new paragraphs. Okay. You can create an element, and then you specify what type of element you create, and it will return the new element node. So usually you have some element like x equal create element for p, for paragraph. You can create within those paragraphs or other elements text nodes. So this will basically be text, just pure text, not with a type of element. It's just creating a node that holds text. So if you remember right at the beginning of the class, we showed the DOM element, the DOM tree, and under elements, there is the text under that element. So one example would be a title in the head, or an H, the link, the text that is shown for a specific link. So under anchor, the text that will be shown in the link. So create will basically create elements or create text nodes. Then you can add children to other two nodes. So add child for a certain node, you can add another node as a child. It adds that child to a node. Insert before, if you are in a child already, you can insert a node before the specific child under the parent, the common parent of the two children. Remove child removes a node from the DOM. Replace child replaces one child with another child in the DOM. And I have examples for all of them. So let's start with the first one, creating and removing nodes in the DOM. So this is an HTML page in which I have one division with ID, the division. And under that division, I have a header for Hello World, a paragraph with ID 1, paragraph with ID 2, and paragraph with ID 4. And then I have a button that invokes the method remv for the document at element that gets element by ID 2. So basically, I'm calling the method remv for this node that contains 2. And that happens the moment that one clicks the button. So it's basically on click event for that button. I finish the division for the division, and then I'm loading the demo script that I have below, this demo script. In the demo script, basically, I have code that is executed at the beginning when the file is loaded. New paragraph creates a new element with paragraph P, a new paragraph. Then I create the content of that paragraph. I create a text node that says this is a new paragraph. I append to the new paragraph that I created that specific child, which is the content. So basically, this creates something similar to, let me just write it here. So this creates, if I delete the body, this creates something similar to, here is a paragraph P, which contains, this is a paragraph text. So, but I do it in JavaScript. So it basically creates the new paragraph, and then it creates, this is a new paragraph within the text. And I'm adding that content to the current, to the paragraph, new paragraph as a child. Then a new variable div element is defined for the division, the parent of all of these paragraphs. And then I'm appending the new paragraph to that division. So even if this is the HTML, this will basically add at the end, this is a new paragraph, this paragraph. The function remove takes the element with ID 2 and for the goes up in the parent node of that the element, which is the div, and removes that child with which was basically the element with ID 2. So it basically, the moment that somebody clicks on the button, click to remove 2, it basically removes the second paragraph. So it gets to this page after the click. So let's do this simple test, and then we'll see if there are any questions. So first I modify the index.html, then I modify the JavaScript with the JavaScript that I wrote. And I'm loading the index. So the JavaScript that I had here at the beginning is actually already executed. It created this additional paragraph and it added it at the end. And on click for the button, click to remove paragraph 2, will basically remove paragraph 2. And again, if you are looking in the source code, you will see that paragraph 2 is actually not removed from the HTML. And also, it doesn't add additionally that code that we had that was basically not added. It will be added by the JavaScript. There is some source code that is added by the live server, but that's because it basically I'm using this live server extension for VS Code. Okay, any questions?
Professor, I have a question.
Go ahead.
So for why do you actually need this function to remove? Like at the end, you have the function remv element.
Yep.
Yeah, this function. But if we click in the button once, it's already like take this
Like we did in the previous example, I can take this code and put it directly here instead of calling the function. You are completely right. Like basically this function remv is really just executing one single line of JavaScript, which I could take and put it here for this button. I just wanted to show you that you can define a function in your script and you can invoke it in on click. So in the previous example, we directly wrote it here. Now we changed the color of the text by just clicking and we were not invoking a function. But yeah, in this example, I'm showing that you can actually define functions, which is totally, this is the norm, what usually people do. They define lots of functions in the JavaScript and then they invoke them from the HTML.
One more thing is like the dot parent node, element dot parent node, which node does it goes to? Like it, does it go
so
to
we invoked we invoke remv for two. So now it goes dot parent goes, what is the parent of button? So button is within the div with id div. So it basically the parent of button is this div tag. So that's the parent node. And now for that, so outside the current, in the parent node, it removes the child, which is two. So basically what I did, I go up and then I remove the element because I can't remove the element within the current element itself.
Oh, okay, okay. Yeah, that's,
so this remove child has to be run in the parent.
Yeah, understood. Thank you, Bruce.
Welcome. There were some other questions in the chat. So professors, there are never any cases when JavaScript can modify the HTML source directly in the client. No, you are actually modifying with JavaScript the DOM. So you're not modifying the HTML itself ever, up to what I know. I don't think so. I don't know of any case where you actually modify the HTML itself. You modify the DOM. How do we decide how much the HTML to put in the HTML and how much to put in JavaScript? It's really a matter of preference. If you are looking at the source code of any important application, like for instance, Gmail, you would see that it contains lots, hundreds of lines of JavaScript, but it also loads other libraries from somewhere else. And that's what usually I do. So if you look at the web page for my class, view page source, you would see that I'm loading JavaScript for various things. Bootstrap, I'm loading all kinds of JavaScripts for different purposes in my page to make it better and make it nicer. So I'm loading jQuery, I'm loading Bootstrap right at the end, before the end of the body. So it's really a matter of preference how you want to distribute your code. Yes, when you inspect a page, the actual size decreases. So there was probably some code made for mobile responsiveness. So one thing that you may again notice in my page is that I'm loading what is called a minimum version of Bootstrap, which eliminates everything that is, it makes it unreadable, but it eliminates all of the extra code, like for instance, comments and everything like that. So it's really, you can't read it anymore. You need some kind of pretty printer to open it and make it readable. So really, you use the functions from Bootstrap or the functions from jQuery, but you are loading a minimized version of that specific library. Yeah, good. Okay, so another example. So in this example, basically, I'm replacing an element. So I had the same code that I had before and the paragraph with ID 2, but now I'm calling repl of the element with ID 2. So this script that basically replaces a node, I'm creating a new element with a paragraph element P, then a text within that element, then I'm appending that text to the paragraph that I just created. And then again, I'm going from the current element, which is 2, to its parent, and then I'm replacing the current element with the new paragraph that I created. The order is actually reversed of what probably would be your intuition and mine. Basically, replace child gets the new paragraph and then the paragraph that will be replaced. So the order is the new paragraph and then the one that you change. Okay. So again, let's copy the code. And I put it all in the HTML, so I don't actually load anything anymore. And I load it with live server. And the moment that you click on replace, it basically replaces the new paragraph. So if we reload it, it's the original paragraph. And then I pass the paragraph 2. Then I get the parent. I create a new paragraph. And I replace paragraph 2 with that new paragraph.
Professor, this might be a bit silly question, but is the string is immutable, right, for the JavaScript?
Yes.
So if you want to change some element in the paragraph, you have to write a new paragraph to replace the old paragraph?
No, not necessarily. You can use inner HTML to change the HTML in that node, in this case, because you are basically changing the text. You can actually get the text node within the paragraph node, like get child, and then you can change the inner HTML with the new text. So it's not JavaScript strings are immutable, but you can give new strings. Basically, you're changing the reference to a new string.
Okay.
So it's really, that's a feature of most modern programming languages, that everything is object and objects are immutable, but you can change references. So,
thank you.
Welcome. Good. And there are many different other DOM actions. I just gave a couple of examples to some of these on click, in fact. But you should try them, all of the others, just to see how they are actually working, and practice makes you better. Okay. Now, jQuery makes this a little bit simpler. I will not get today into jQuery. Again, this is the topic of the next class. It's another way to actually change the same things that we saw today, and I will describe it next class. Basically, there are ways to extract the nodes in an easier way. Like, for instance, get all elements by tag. You can just do this $ and then open parentheses and P that will extract all of the paragraphs. And then you can execute functions on those like hide and so on. So let's stop here today. Respond to whatever other questions are there. It's anyway 5:46. And then you can start playing with basically the quiz that I showed you, and start playing with the homework, because really you should practice everything that you learned today. So any questions left for this class? Can you submit the quiz in a zip file? Yes, because basically we saw that some HTMLs are rejected by Blackboard because it says that there is some security issue with them. So make a zip that contains only that HTML and submit it. Yes, I want you to create not 100 JavaScript objects, but basically either 100 JavaScript objects or create 100 HTMLs with associated methods to do the update for all of these classes as part of the homework. And the reason why it's this big is that I want you to actually do it. I want you to test it, make sure that it works, and practice. Yeah, somebody was asking a question.
My question is the same as the one in chat.
I see. So yes, do it for all classes. That question was asked by Michael in somewhere in the, I believe here. And I responded that one thing, that please do all the classes that are in the CSV. I know there are 100, but it gives you more practice. Yeah, only one HTML file for homework 2. So you have to put all of the code, JavaScript, and HTML into one single HTML file. You can use any library that you want, as long as you can find it on the web. So for instance, in my code, you can use Java jQuery. Load it and then use it, and that's fine with me. You can use any other library that you want, as long as it's available on a public website. I don't know how you can embed Python in your HTML that runs. You can use Python for actually parsing that CSV file and creating JavaScript objects. So that's fine with me. Yes, you just put the show HTML into a zip and submit it as your quiz. You can also play with the quiz and make it better. Yeah, of course you can. I mean, what you do, so you can do the homework, it's really up to you. So you can write a Python script that reads this CSV and generates objects in JavaScript, similar to the ones that we had in our class last time. So basically you can create things like this, like an array of objects that have properties about those classes, like the subject of the class, the course code, the component, and so on. But that is external from what you submit. What you submit is basically a one HTML file that contains the assignment. So yes, you can parse the CSV file to create objects and then write the rest of the code to generate the visible, not visible, similar to the one that we did in the quiz. It has to be in that one file. Yes, that will work. So parse the CSV into a long string that you will basically use into your JavaScript. I do not know the concat method in Excel. Okay, I find this is interesting. So an array of 100 objects would be good for your homework. And it seems that some students like Connor already did it. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. I will post the recording after the class today. See you next week. Have a nice weekend.